In this video, I'll be introducing the laboratory DC power supply. The first thing you might notice about one of these machines is that it has several different ports where you can plug wires in. They have different colors, and the machine also has several knobs. Some of the knobs are labeled current, and some of the knobs are labeled voltage. Let's go ahead and turn this one on. This particular power supply has three different channels. Channel 1 is on the right, so these two indicators refer to channel 1. And channel 2 is on the left, so these two indicators refer to channel 2. Channel 3 is a fixed 5-volt power supply on this particular model. Now let's go ahead and go over to the board, and I'll show you what a lot of these different colors mean. So each one of these DC power supplies has ports where you can plug various cables into it, and they have different colors. And it's important to know the difference, say, between the red cable, the black cable, and the green cable. And that's what I'll describe right now. These particular power supplies are two-channel variable voltage sources. It means that you can dial in whatever voltage you want, and then it will be displayed on the screen. So for example, if I dial in 10 volts, it means that there's now going to be a 10 volt difference between the red port and the black port right there on the channel to the right. If over here on the left, if I were to dial in 20 volts, it means that there would be a 20 volt difference between these two terminals. It's very important to know that these two voltages are not related to one another. In other words, this is an example of a floating DC power supply. When I say floating, it means that the voltage isn't referenced to something external to the power supply. For example, if you imagine a situation where we have a power line, and let's assume that it's a DC line, and it's hooked up to a battery, and that battery is grounded, and this particular line is at 100 volts. We're assuming a DC situation here. And we have a person that touches his hand to the volts, and he is standing on the ground. That would obviously be a very dangerous thing to do, because this is not an example of a floating power supply. However, if we have a power supply where the 100 volts is floating, and this terminal is not connected to the ground, then this would, in theory, be a safe situation. In other words, there's a very key difference between floating power supplies and power supplies that are not floating. And the difference is that non-floating power supplies have a reference to the Earth. In these power supplies, that reference is provided by this green grounding pin. So if you were to tie one of these connections to the green grounding pin, I now have a positive 10 volts with respect to ground. On the other hand, if I were to make a similar connection with the other channel and instead tie the red connection to the earth, then it means, because this is 20 volts below the red connection, I can say that this is a negative 20 volts with respect to the earth. Right, but without those connections there, it's just simply an example of a floating power supply. Let's now consider a very simple circuit. I'm going to imagine a situation where I have a 10 ohm resistor connected to the DC power supply, and assume that I've turned the power supply on so that current will start to flow around the circuit. With the power supply turned on, I should have 1 ampere of current flowing around the loop. And then the power supply will display 1 ampere under the current label. But when the power supply is turned off, this number does not typically show 0 amperes. Because the display has a dual meaning with these power supplies and a lot of power supplies, and it's related to the limit. In other words, this power supply has a feature that can help you protect devices. If this resistor, for example, is rated at only 0.25 watts, then let's consider whether the situation I've shown here is a safe situation for the resistor or not. We know that power is voltage times current, and we have 10 volts and 1 ampere. So in this case, we have 10 watts of power that would need to be dissipated by that resistor. That would be a very dangerous situation. So if I were to hook it up this way, the resistor would burn out immediately. How can we avoid that? And one way that we might be able to avoid it is to use the limit feature of the DC power supply. Here's how it works. There's two knobs on the power supply. One knob controls the voltage. We've already discussed this situation. But there's another knob that controls the limit setting on the current. And it is possible in advance to dial in some maximum amount of current that you want the voltage source to be able to output. But for example, if I dial in 0.1 ampere before the output is switched on, then it means that for whatever voltage I dial in, that voltage might not actually be output if the supply senses that the current will be exceeded. So, what will happen if I try to dial in 0.1 amperes and 10 volts with a 10 ohm resistor hooked up to the power supply? All right, well first, how much current would flow? With 10 volts and 10 ohms, we normally expect 1 ampere of current. However, because I've set the limit at 0.1 ampere, then this is not accurate anymore. Only 0.1 ampere of current would actually be flowing, and the voltage would no longer be accurate. I wouldn't actually be able to make it to 10 volts with this particular setting. The voltage would only reach 1 volt. Let's go and actually wire up this circuit and see what happens with the power supply. So now let's go ahead and construct the circuit that I just drew. I've got here a 10 ohm resistor that's rated at 0.25 watt, and I'm going to hook it up to channel 1 of the DC power supply. We can go ahead and turn the power supply on, and just because the power supply to the equipment is on, it doesn't mean that there's power coming out of these two terminals. You see, the power out of these two terminals is controlled by an extra on-off output switch over here. So if I turn the output on, then whatever I dial in, which is currently 0 volts, would show up across these terminals. So if I turn the voltage up, then I could set, say, 5 volts. And the current knob then tells me what the limit is for the current that would be going through these wires. Now, currently, there's no current flowing at all. So if I turn this up, it means that, well, the limit's a lot higher, but the actual current flowing at the moment is 0. Well, let's move the limit down and turn it off. So when the output is off, I should see some indication here of what the limit is. Let's set the starting voltage to 1 volt, and let's set the limit also to, say, 0.3 ampere. This means that when I turn the output on, the laboratory power supply will put 1 volt across these two terminals, and it would allow a maximum of 0.3 amperes to flow through the circuit. So I'll go ahead and hook it up to the resistor, and this is a 10 ohm resistor. And if we turn on the output, we can see that we have 1 volt across the resistor, and currently 0.1 amperes of current are flowing. And if I take voltage times current, I get 0.1 watts. Now the resistor is rated at 0.25 watt, so it can definitely dissipate that much power because 0.1 watt is less than 0.25 watts. If I try to increase the voltage for a while, the current will increase too. But when I get beyond my limit, the current will stop increasing. You see, now as I turn the voltage knob, nothing happens. As I continue to increase the voltage, everything is kind of clamped. And this color here has changed from green to red, indicating some sort of a problem. In this case, I've hit my current limit. So let me bring the voltage back down, and let's change the limit. And I hope you can start to get some idea of why the limit might be important. You see, the limit can protect equipment in the circuit, or in this case, this particular resistor. If I turn the current up so the machine can output a maximum of 3.22 amperes. The voltage is set to zero, so when I turn it on, nothing's going to happen. And the display here is now indicating that 0 amperes of current is actually flowing now that the output is on. And as I start increasing the voltage, the current starts increasing linearly. And of course, V times I is the power that's currently being dissipated in the resistor. If I start turning it up, eventually I'm going to hit the point where V times I exceeds 0.25 watt. When that happens, the resistor is going to have a problem because it won't be able to dissipate the power that I'm trying to supply to it. So I'm increasing it rather slowly. Okay, there the resistor has a problem. It's unable to dissipate this much power. Let me turn off the output. And where were we in terms of current? So 6.5 volts, V squared over R would give me the power. So if we say 6 volts over 10, so that's 36 divided by 10, so about 3.6 watts. And the resistor was rated at 0.25 watt. So I definitely exceeded the ratings. But 3.6 watts would not exceed the rating of this larger resistor. So this is also a 10 ohm resistor. They're both 10 ohm resistors, but this larger resistor is rated at 5 watts, which means that it should be able to handle 3.6 volts across it without catching on fire. Let's give it a try. I'm just going to leave the settings right where they were. I had 6.5 volts across the resistor. So six, let me turn it down to six. Six squared divided by 10 ohms is 3.6 watts, which is less than 5. So this is within the rating of this resistor, and it's not on fire, and we don't have any problems. All right, so that brings us to the end of this video on the DC power supply. Let's coil up the cords really nice. It's always good to leave a power supply looking neat. There. If you enjoyed watching this video, then you might be interested in following our playlist and learning more about the fundamentals of electrical circuits.